Good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome to today's class on research writing and communication. Today's topic is research ethics, and this program is organized by the Consciousness Studies program at the National Institute of Advanced Studies, Bangalore. And we are all familiar with Madhurima ma'am by now. We had a short break, but we are resuming classes now, and the renewed course schedule is also being sent to you. So I'm having a slight network issue. I'm very sorry about that. Apologies. Trying to fix that. But anyway, so welcoming all of you, and we'll start today's class. Ma'am, you are unmuted. Are you unable to unmute yourself?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, now we can hear you.
All right. Thank you so much, Meera. Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to the course.
Just a minute, ma'am. Can I take a few minutes to fix the calls and all of that? The
internet sure.
Yeah. So I'll get back to you. Ma'am, you can continue with the class. I will just put all the worksheets on the chat.
Sure. Yeah. Sounds good. All right. Welcome back to the course. We had an unexpected break for 2 weeks, but we are back. And I'm hoping that you all have seen the rescheduled classes. And, sorry about the inconvenience that's being caused. Today's session is where we look at research ethics, right? Over the last couple of sessions, we understood what is research, how do you write, what are the essentials of writing. We looked at various components of research paper. And we looked at methodology, literature review, we looked at introduction, we looked at references, citation. The handout for the last module, along with it, in your references segment, I've not only shared the links from where I've taken the notes, but I've also shared you all names of a couple of books which you can download and use. And I have shared a PDF copy of a book that was easily available. Okay, so the idea is this. I mean, what I have shared with all of you is very generic, but a lot of times we get, research methodology books which are very specific to our area. So for example, if I'm looking at it from the perspective of policy or from the perspective of psychology, I could actually get research methodology books where the authors speak from that perspective. So while the books that I have shared are for your generic understanding, please go and look for books if there are specific ones related to your area of work, because some nuances of methodology are very specific. So the book links that I have shared or the PDF copy of the book that I think has been shared with all of you is a very generic thing. It will give you a basic idea. But then if you want to delve further, for example, some of you are only doing qualitative work, you will have to look at books in qualitative methodology, right? Which gives a more detailed version of it. People who are, say, looking at content analysis in a particular manner, right? And triangulation, you will have to look at books which deal with that. So please understand, as research scholars, you all also need to do a bit of work on your own. We can only give you a little nudge, okay? But we expect that you will also go and look up a little more, all right? So today's session is on research ethics. And with that, we actually look at the research components of writing. The next module, okay, which is going to be actually spread over 6 hours, is a lot more to do with more practical skills of research writing and communication, more to do with communication, because we're going to do narrative styles, we're going to do presentation tools and all that in the next 6 hours. So the next 6 hours after today are very, very important because they're all connected together, right? And I will be giving you exercises which will connect across those 6 hours. Okay, so those exercises will be sent a little prior to all of you. And I will expect some amount of work from each of you to do that. Okay, so for today's session, there's also a particular handbook with a case study and a couple of exercises. The error is on my part. I was a little late in sharing it with Meera. So I think Meera has sent you an email. Meera, has the email gone out to all the participants with the handbook for today? Have you all got an email? Can you just check that? We'll also be putting it up on the chat. Okay, so during the session, when we use it, you will have access to that. Okay, you have got it on email. Okay, fantastic. All right, so please download it. We have a case study and 2 exercises for today. So let me share the screen and let's begin our class without much delay. Okay. I hope you all can see my presentation. Okay. All right. So we're looking at ethics and research, and we will look at a couple of components here. Okay. We will understand what are ethical tenets in research. What is it that you have to keep in mind? What does ethics even mean, right? When we look at it from a research perspective. And then we will look at the large part of ethics and research, writing, which is plagiarism. And we will tell you why is plagiarism not all right, right? We know it's not, but why is it not good? What is its impact? What does this tell somebody about a research? And why do we need to keep that in mind? Okay, so these are the things that we are going to be looking at. And before we start ethical tenets, let me ask you a question. What is ethics? What is ethics in your opinion? You will receive an exercise book for today. Don't worry, it's on the way. Ethics is moral values, Amit. Okay, what else? Ideology, all right, doing good, avoiding bad, morally correct, manners, values. Okay, what ought to be done? Rules, right and wrong, difference between right and wrong. Social norms, right behavior, code of conduct, rules and regulations, okay? Yes, yes, all of it. Some of these things, right, when you say rules and regulation, norms of a society, values, these are things which are roughly anything that is non-consensual is unethical. Okay. So primarily, the entire understanding of ethics is this, right? I mean, there are different ways to tell researchers what is ethical and what is not. So there are some practice elements in it. But then it's important for all of us, to understand, like Victor, you're saying morality, right? How do we define that morality, right? And where do we understand that the means to an end are equally important in research? So that's where ethics comes in, okay? And the initial work on ethics was primarily from a very, very medical point of view. But then the particular Nuremberg Code of Ethics applies even now for all of us. Okay, so let's understand what it is. But while we do that, I have a little poll. Meera, can you put this poll link up on the chat, please? The poll link up on the chat. Okay, I'm not sure, Meera, if you heard me, I'm also going to copy it. Yeah, thanks Ashwini for putting that in. Okay, all of you, it's one single link. Okay, access the link. Let us see what you all have to say and I'll show you what it is. I hope you all have taken the poll. Difficult to choose one. Yes, Narasimha, it is, but you have to choose. I think I've given you all an option. Okay. No, I have given you only one option to choose. I've made it difficult. I want you all to choose only one out of this, which you think is unethical. Let us see what this means, okay? Let us see what you all have chosen. Okay. Okay, 84 of you. Come on, participants. Okay. Are you all able to see my screen? Participants, are you all able to see the screen with the results? It is difficult to choose one. Yes, I understand. The idea is that. The idea is to see what's your perspective. Okay. All right, about 95 of you. Let's see what's coming up. Plagiarism of content has come up as an unethical act of research, okay, followed by fabrication of data. We'll also understand what is the difference between fabricating data and falsification of data. I will talk to you about it. Breaching participant confidentiality, not informing subject about study details is low. Not allowing voluntary withdrawal is very low. Not taking consent form is a 3. Not giving another author due credit, okay? Okay, so plagiarism of content, according to you, is the most unethical component of research. But I understand I've asked, given you a choice of only one, okay? Breaching participant confidentiality, does it cover all of it? It could be an umbrella term, but it again depends on how we look at it, but yes. Okay, we have all chosen. All right, that's 109 of you. Okay, so plagiarism of content seems like the most important thing. Ashwini is also sharing the... No, plagiarism and content and not giving another author due credit are not the same, Gayatri. They are two different things. Plagiarism is where you could be copying from multiple sources, but not giving another author. So you have a second or a third author on the paper, but then you know they have worked with you, but you have not given them credit. That's not giving another author credit. So they're two different things, right? So you could have somebody else who's worked with you, but then you've not given them the credit at all. Okay. Okay. All right. So plagiarism seems like, you know, the most, in your opinion, the most important thing. All right. Fair enough. The idea is all of it. Okay. All of it is unethical. All your options were unethical. I just wanted to see what, according to you or in your opinion, seems like the most important thing. Okay. All right. It's like this. Can you see my slide? Zoom is very slow today for some reason. Can you all see my slide? Yes, no? Can you all see a Calvin and Hobbes thing? Yes, you can. Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay. So I absolutely love this comic strip. It says, I read this ethics book, you got me. And his mom says, what did you think of it? It really made me see things differently. It's given me a lot to think about. I'm glad you enjoyed it. It's complicating my life. Don't get me anymore, right? Ethics is complicated because it's not that simple to decipher, okay? But at the same time, it's very, very important for all of us to follow ethical code of conduct in research, okay? All of those options on the poll are all unethical forms of behavior, and they could differ in degree, but they're still unethical. Just because you're doing less of something doesn't mean it's less unethical. It's unethical. There's no less and more in it. Okay. But then when research ethics came about, it was because there were a lot of research ethics scandals that happened. Okay. As early as I have only taken about 3 examples here to talk to you, show you, you know, how research ethics, you know, and people not following ethics can be very, very scandalous in nature and how it can have a lot of untoward impact. Okay. So one of the earliest cases was from 1796, very famous Edward Jenner's smallpox vaccine case in England. Okay, this research involved injecting an 8-year-old child with pus from the cowpox infection and then deliberately exposing the child to the smallpox to establish the acquired immunity. Now, while it was a great step forward in the fight against smallpox, the exposure to the risk this involved for the child would be unlikely to be not condoned today. Okay. Now, this was unethical because the child's consent was not taken, right? So this was one of the earliest scandals that happened. And when you look at it today, it's not done, right? Today, even the current COVID vaccine, we all have to sign, take an undertaking, we have to fill up a form. We know what we are taking, right? We are aware of it. We are aware of what could be the possible side effects. But in the early years, 200-300 years back, this kind of consent component was not there. Okay. Yes, Dr. Sharmishtha, if you can also elaborate on that example, okay, then that would be good. Sharmishtha, can you unmute yourself? The syphilis case study, how it was a breach of research ethics. Sharmishtha, can you unmute yourself? Meera, can you let her unmute herself so that she can speak? Or we can take that at the end of the session also. Okay. Or we can take that at the end of the session. That's one example. The Shamisha, just give us a minute. Let Meera figure that out. The other example was in 1920s in the United States, which was called the Little Albert Experiment. Okay, it was to demonstrate the phenomenon of human conditioning by conditioning an 11-month-old infant to fear rats by associating that fear with loud noise. Okay, now Albert's parents' consent was not taken for this study. Albert's parents thought that the child was participating in a particular, you know, experiment, but they didn't really know the details of it. And therefore, it was completely unethical. Okay. Then when we look at 1939 to 1945, all the medical experimentation that happened in Nazi Germany, okay, where concentration camp prisoners were subjected to experiments on involuntary sterilization, radiation, freezing to induce hypothermia, infection of them with malaria and TB. Okay, and a lot of this was done without their consent. Okay, and it often led to pain, mutilation, and death of the participants. But again, like I said, I am quoting examples which are almost about 70, 80 years old. Okay, from the recent time, I do see one of the participants who's asking me to comment on the Wuhan and the lab. I am not going to comment on that right now. Because we are still dealing with it. So right now, maybe let's focus. But I'm sure there's enough writing to understand what's happening and what's not. Okay, for now, I think the world is busy dealing with the virus and finding, maybe solutions to, take care of people who are infected with it and to protect the population who's not yet been infected with it. Sharmishtha, are you able to speak up? Ashwini is trying to unmute you.
Yes, I'm now able to.
All right, Sharmishtha, can you please share that experiment with everyone for everyone's benefit?
Yes. In the United States, in Alabama State, actually, mm-hmm. and this the some African men who are suffering from syphilis, the vaccine already had been invented, but mm-hmm. The researchers actually kept that a secret from the participants who actually took part in it, and they kept on researching. They wanted to find out how long they remain affected and what are the symptoms that they develop when they get affected through syphilis and what are the long-term impact. At the time when the vaccine was already there and there was a cure, but they didn't present the cure to those affected. So this actually had a huge, when they later came to know that the vaccine was there and still they kept on researching on them. So there was a huge psychological as well as a physical impact, and some participants also passed away due to this unethical research. So
it's, actually, if we look at the research done in a lot of medical-based research, there are a lot of case studies like that which come out, right? And obviously, while the Code of Conduct came in, I think the Nuremberg Code of Conduct came in 1945, post that also what we have seen is that the Code of Conduct has been revised, okay? And it's applicable across, not just the medical research area, but if you actually look at the document of the Code of Conduct, it's really massive. I'm only sharing a couple of important keynotes from there today. Okay, the norms of modern research ethics were actually codified by the Nuremberg Code, 1947. And this was primarily in response to the Nazi medical research. And then later it was developed by the World Medical Association's Declaration of Helsinki in 1964 and again revised in 1975. Okay. So this actually tells us how we need to take consent from participants, how we need to look at, how participants have to understand the implications of our research. Participants have to understand what can be the side effects of that research and how we should not, hide information. Yes, we have some more examples. Yes, Harsh, the Stanford Prison Experiment of 1971. Again, very, very interesting, case study to look at. What I would like to do is, Ashwini and Meera, if you can just make a note of all these, examples, okay, which the participants have shared. Maybe we can also put that across later in a single document. I can add them to the document for extra reading for all of them. Can you do that, Ashwini, please? Yes, the father of gynecology, yes, Anvesha, who performed the experiments on enslaved Black women. And a lot of these gave rise to surgical techniques, but the fact is that he did it on women who were impoverished and who did not have a say in the matter at all. Okay, so that is something that we have to, understand and keep in mind. But again, none of these examples, right? None of these examples are really black and white. Okay, because what they did at that point of time, they thought it was all right, because a lot of times the you know, work was being done by a particular segment of society, and they had a particular segment of society who were subjected to these experiments. Okay. But it is unethical. It is not right, because you're breaching confidentiality, you're breaching somebody's privacy, you're breaching somebody's right to good health, because you're putting them under risk. And that's where the code of conduct becomes very, very important. Okay. Now, what is research ethics? Okay. It is about questions which relate to what kind of lives we should lead, right? That's ethics. What is good society? What is right? What is wrong? This is what all of you said, right? What qualities should we develop as people? What responsibilities do we have as human beings towards each other? What is the ecosystem that we are looking to build, right? But when you look at research ethics per se, it's about the harms and benefits of research. Do the benefits of research outweigh the harm that it can cause the participants? What is the right of the participants to information? What is the right of the participants to privacy? Okay, to anonymity, to the responsibility of we researchers to act with integrity. Okay, all of this becomes important. Okay, that not only do we maintain the privacy of our participants, we also make sure that we take their consent before we do the experiment with them, or we do a study with them. We maintain anonymity. We have a responsibility towards them so that there's no harm that comes to them. Right? These are things that are part of the research ethics. But what is the code of conduct and ethics? What are the few things? The three or four things which are very important. The legal and the moral obligation to protect their right. Right? It's not just a legal aspect. It's, you don't have to be ethical because somebody could sue you. You have to be ethical because it's your moral obligation, because that's the least you can do as a researcher, that you protect the right of your subjects. Okay, always disclose full information about the research prior to anybody participating in it, right? Do not make up wrong ideas about your research. Do not tell them it's about something when it's not. For example, a lot of times when we study sensitive data, a lot of researchers may hesitate to talk about what the data is actually going to be about. But it's important that your participants know exactly what you're looking at. Right? Ensuring that the population under study does not come to any harm because of your research. Okay, I can take the example of studying violence, because one of my master's project work was with the Women's Helpline in Bengaluru. And I was doing casework, and I had to look at and analyze about 60 case studies for my master's thesis. And during the course, I had to be sure, because there was a consent form, but I also had to be sure that not just the victim, but the victim's family, the person who came with her to file the complaint, was also on board with participating in the study, right? Because we did not want that the victim goes back and then, you know, they're again beaten up, or there's some other repercussion on them because they have actually agreed to participate in a study. So these are very sensitive matters. They're important. And as a researcher, you'll have to spend time to understand the delicateness of situations like this. And how do you ensure that your population does not come to any harm, right? And it's important, very, very important for all of us, whether we are doing experimental-based work, whether we are doing work in medical diagnosis, whether we are looking at social aspects, okay, where a population could come to harm. Okay, whether we are studying marginalized populations, where we are looking at their rights, we are looking at what's happening with them, we also have to ensure that we are able to protect the people we are studying. Okay, and if there's an adverse effect, it's important to take suitable and remedial action. Okay, there was a particular study when we were looking at some sensitive elements, and we were chased by a set of people from the village because they didn't want us to study that particular aspect. It was an economic aspect of tea pricing. And there were this set of people who literally chased us away because they said, you know what, we don't want you coming and asking questions, despite us having all, permission letters, everything from the government. Okay. And at that point, we realized it was a very sensitive social situation. And we couldn't do work there because there was a group of people who were against us getting data which was on the field. Okay, at that point, we decided not to push on that particular day. We actually stepped back. We went back, had discussions. We got things to be more stringent. We figured out a way to navigate that space. But as researchers, it's important not to take harsh decisions, not to rush into things. If you see any form of behavior on the field, if you're a primary data person, you'll have to know when to step back. it's very, very important to do that. Okay.
Ma'am, I have a question. I couldn't
help
this question. Since you mentioned Nuremberg Code, the third Nuremberg Code reads like this: the experiment should be so designed and based on the results of animal experimentation and the knowledge of the natural history of the disease or other problem under study that the anticipated results justify the performance of the experiment. So this quote particularly mandates that if a clinical study or therapeutic research is underway, before it actually gets to commence, the animal experiment, the product or the vaccine has to be tested on non-human life forms. But isn't the research ethics also extend to the scope and covers also the non-human species or life forms as well, especially the higher mammals?
Yeah, so the thing is, see, the code, that Nuremberg Code, when it first came out, right, it looked at it from the perspective of the, what was our initial medical research, mostly on animals, right? Rats, cats, pigeons, okay? Most of the experiments were done on that. A lot of psychology experiments have been done on chimpanzees, right? Now, yeah. Initial experiments were mostly on maybe lower order animals, okay? Later, there has been a revised version. Do not right now immediately have the details of the revised version of it. But the whole idea is this. The whole idea is that any life form whom you bring into that experimental setup should not be harmed because of the experiment. That's the basic code of research. Have you got that? Yeah. So
yes.
Any life form, whether you're doing the experiment on dogs, whether you're doing them on cats, on rats, on pigeons, or whether you're doing them on chimpanzees, whether you're doing them on guinea pigs, whether you're doing them on, you know, like you said later, on human beings, you know, where, for example, say a lot of diseases where you have experimental drugs, right? And a lot of people suffering from those diseases by choice take part in those experimental drugs, right? Trials.
Yes.
Now, that is something they take because they are okay, right? They are okay to experiment and see if that treatment will work for them or not. But then there's a consent there. But if the same thing had to be done without the consent of the participants and the doctor on their own decided, this is my experimental group, this is my control group, and let me try this out, then it's unethical. So over the years, look at the code in the context of the time at which it was made.
Okay.
Right. Obviously, over time, it has changed. Right. Today, just the way, you know, a lot of products which were tested on animals, maybe 20, 30 years back, today, people are completely moving away from testing products on animals. Correct. We are finding ways to test products and the efficacy of products and, you know, allergy reactions that can happen to people. Right. How many of us would have heard of a patch test, say, 20, 30 years back? Right. But today, most of the cosmetic industry will ask people to try a patch test before they kind of start using the products, right? Because everything is today about protecting and ensuring that there is no liability to the participants who use your products or who are part of that system, correct? So what was the initial code obviously has to be adapted over time, right? The word-to-word verbatim component of the code may not apply now immediately. But we all as researchers have to adapt and understand what is the larger component of that code. What does it actually mean? Right? For example, say somebody is looking at, I have a lot of questions here on the chat. I do see that. Now, say you're looking at a vulnerable population. Okay. The vulnerable population could be people belonging to a particular indigenous group, could be people belonging to a particular caste. The vulnerable population could be somebody studying the impact of a particular medicine on a particular set of cancer patients, right? They're all vulnerable. The code of conduct at the end of the day states that there should be no harm to any of these participants, irrespective of the kind of study you do. Or say you're trying to understand religious practices of a particular group, okay, of a group that is really small in number. At no point of time should your study, which is on their religious practices, harm the religious practice or present it in a light that will harm them. Correct? So do you see how the original code of ethics can actually be adapted and applied across streams? Sharmisha, have I answered your question? I think it was you who was asking the question. Yeah, okay. So that is what we need to keep in mind. Okay, now what are the, there are about, yeah. Okay, there are about 8 ethical things from a research point of view. Okay, and this is across disciplines. Okay, this is not something that's going to only apply to one research group and not to the other. This is something that will apply to all of you across. One is consent. Okay, what do you do when you cannot get informed and prior consent from the participants? You cannot have those participants be a part of your study without consent. There is no two ways about it. Nobody else can consent on behalf of your participant. Obviously, in some cases, we do have, for example, even filing a complaint for sexual harassment, it says that if the person is not in a psychological state, then a particular guardian can actually file the complaint on their behalf. But something like that, that kind of a consent may not really work in research. For children who are minors, yes, parents have to consent. But in a situation where you're not able to get the consent from adults who are of sound mind, it would more than often mean that they're not interested in participating. So you cannot force people to participate in your study. Scientific merit. Can innovative research that does not involve participant risk but is of certain merit be justified? Okay, so it is innovative. There's no risk to the participant, but the merit is uncertain, which means I'm not sure if it will really benefit the participants. Okay, so there's no harm, but I'm also not sure of benefit. Now, this is something that as researchers, you will have to take a chance on. Okay, say for example, I'm looking at a policy on employee engagement, which I'm suggesting to organizations. And I'm saying, if you do this practice, so, you know, we work for 5 days a week, why don't you make it work only for 4 days a week, take that day off. Now, there is no harm to the participant, right? There is no risk in a policy change like that. You're just saying that, okay, whatever workload you have, you'll have to do it over those 3 days and maybe finish your workload. But then you're also not sure of the merit. Will that really increase employee engagement? Will people put in their best in those 4 days because they're getting one extra day off? Or maybe that one extra day off is once a month or once every 2 weeks, fortnightly. Okay. Now, in such cases, you will have to decide, does the merit outweigh? So it's a very case-to-case decision. In that ways, you cannot have a single ethical aspect which, you know, kind of impacts across the industry. It's not possible. That decision has to be case to case. Then the conflict of interest. If there's any conflict of interest in what you're studying and what is the product of the research, do not do it. Okay. If I have some gain out of participating in the research, I should not be part of that research because that's a conflict of interest. Risk versus benefit. The benefit of a research have to be higher than the possible risks at any point of time. And the risks have to be really, really low, really, really minimal, something that does not harm their health, that does not have be a concern which can cause their death. This is something very, very important. Protecting vulnerable people. Okay. If your research participants are vulnerable, how do you protect them? How do you ensure that you have not only got the consent from them, but the fact that they have spoken to you, they do not come to harm. Okay, this is something that has to be really taken care of. Okay, a lot of journalistic pieces which work on honor killing, right? Obviously, names are often changed in articles and, you know, the entire raw data of the articles are very rarely openly published or are on open source platforms. It's important for those journalists and for those researchers to protect the vulnerable people, right? And that's, I'm just giving you one single example. Disclosing information to participants and their families, okay? How much about the research should you talk about? Anything that impacts them, you should talk about it, right? Now, there are some unsaid things about research. For example, you have decided to study a particular impact, okay, of a particular nutritional product on maternal health, for example. So you are giving out that product in villages and you're asking women to have it, but you have already ensured that there is no side effect of that product. But then you will, it's possible that the product will not only help them with their calcium content, but the product may also help them with, you know, improving their energy level and some other impacts. But those impacts have not been completely studied. So you may not talk about the impact, but only a positive thing. But any possible harm that can come from the product, you will have to talk about that. So if something is positive, it is okay not to completely tell it to them unless you're sure. But if something is not going to be helpful to them, it's important that you delineate it out clearly. Okay, so harm is something that has to be avoided at all cost. If there is a benefit, the benefit can come to them in slowly and it's all right. Privacy, you'll have to ensure that you keep the privacy of your participants. And of course, there has to be confidentiality. You cannot give out confidential information. is it ethical to give incentive to participants of a research? It depends on what kind of incentives are we talking about, right? For example, at times, you know, in rural areas, when you do research, we have gone and arranged for tea and biscuits for all participants, right? But will that encourage them to give false data? I don't think so. It may just make them feel good. So you'll have to decide. You can't monetize data. Okay, that is ethically not allowed. You cannot give them money in return for data, but maybe you can arrange for a chai, you can arrange for some biscuits and some snacks for people who come and participate. Okay, a lot of times if you have school children or college students participating in some kind of a survey, you usually give them a certificate saying they have been a part of it. That kind of a benefit is okay, but you cannot give people money for participating. Yeah, so institutes that work on animal experimentation, they have their own set of, you know, ethical code, okay, which is very specific to the organizations which are working on it, okay? So for that, you will have to look at the specific code that organizations have. Yeah, you can't expect one who does not want to be helped to actually receive help. That's very, very true. Janet, but that is something a lot of people who approach therapists may not understand, and it takes participants time to understand that. Okay. All right. Now, when you look at field work research, okay, when you're going to the field, few simple things to keep in mind. Always be honest. Ashita, when you say that most American universities use monetary compensation for what? I'm not going to get into an argument on research by corporates and how some of it may be to benefit their own thing. That's a completely different trail of conversation. But yes, for research participation, some organizations, some institutes do give money, but they openly then talk about giving money. They tell you that if you participate in this, you will get a particular amount of money. So I'm going to give you a case study, which we have shared already with you, where there is that component of benefit. Okay, and we will discuss how ethical it is. Right, again, there's no single thing, it is very case to case. So I can participate, but then I also have to be sure that I am participating and giving them the right information, and I'm not participating just because they're giving me money to participate in the research. It's exactly like how we look at the policy on blood donation and organ donation, right? I mean, can you really give money, all right? In UK, they look at a regulated market wherein they say that we can have money, but give money to participants who are donating organs or donating blood. But at the same time, it has to be a regulated market. But then there are some countries in the world which say that organ donation and blood donation has to be completely free. All right? So these are constant ethical things that people deal with, right? And when you look at that problem from a policy perspective, from a policymaker's perspective, do you look at a paternalistic approach? Do you look at a libertarian paternalistic approach? That becomes important, right? So if you look at a libertarian paternalistic approach, which means my patient has to have a choice of where they can get that blood from, which they need for, say, their surgery. But at the same time, they should have enough choice. So they should have blood banks whom they can approach. They should have private agencies whom they can approach. And if a patient is ready to pay money to get the blood in a critical situation, can the market be regulated for that? Right? Or do we have to just have a government regulation which puts people on a list and says, okay, first come, first serve basis. As long as there is a match of the organ, you are next in line. But then we also know that there are long queues for organ donation. So there cannot be a single thing, that a code that can be applied across the world. If it's only question as Zelichka, you will have to at least tell them what is the main component of the study, how is it going to impact people, what are you going to do with that data? Okay, that becomes important. Okay, so you don't have to tell them what are you expecting and what will it impact, what are the kind of policies you're making. You're not going to have to tell them all that detail, because that is something you will also not be sure till you do the complete study. But at least you need to tell them what is the objective of the study, who are the people you're studying, and why are you studying, right? And obviously, how will it impact them, giving you that information, and the fact that you're not going to share that information with somebody else. Okay, so that becomes important, getting informed consent, voluntary participation. Okay, the only exception in India, obviously, is the census survey, which is everybody has to participate. There is no voluntary aspect in it. Okay, respect for participants, confidentiality, anonymity, and privacy is important. Do not harm the participants or minimize the harm that can come to them. Okay, rapport and friendship. How much of rapport and friendship should you build with your participants? Okay, only to some extent. You're not there to talk about your private lives. They're not there to talk to you about their private lives. The rapport has to be just enough for you to be able to do the study. But yeah, if you're doing a longitudinal study, for example, the 75-year happiness survey that is being done across the world, where they have followed a set of Ivy League graduates, for the last 75 years of their lives. Okay, if you look at that happiness study, every few years, the set of researchers who take over the study has changed. Okay, and the people who are leading the study in the last few years and who are talking about the impact of that happiness survey will tell you that they have somewhere built a rapport, right? They have some set of people who call up these participants every 2 years to understand how happy they are. Okay, I'm not sure how many of you have heard of this happiness survey that's been done. Have any of you heard of it? Okay, it's a happiness study that's been going on for about 75 years now. Okay, yeah, it's a longitudinal study, very, very interesting, and which says that our happiness is primarily derived not from our income, not from our laurels, but from our interpersonal relationships. Okay, so then the intrusiveness. How intrusive should you be in a study? Not at all, right? I mean, one of my initial forays into research was a geriatric health project with St. John's Hospital, Bangalore, soon after my master's, and it was a WHO project. And, we were studying geriatric health, but we had a clear consent form. We had a clear list of questions. And we also had a list of questions which we shouldn't ask the elderly people, okay? Things which were intrusive. For example, if they live alone, we are not supposed to probe and ask them, why are they not living with their children? Simple things like that, right? These things are also about being ethical in field work, okay? Inappropriate behavior. As researchers, your behavior has to be appropriate. You have to be polite. How are you interpreting your data? How are you owning your data? How are you talking about it? That becomes important. Are you expressing what you want to see through your data? Or are you talking about what your data actually shows? Okay, that also becomes very, very important. Now, what are the adverse effects at times when you have research where participants take part? One is participants could be emotionally disturbed by questions. Right, so you have to be very, very careful how you ask your questions. What kind of questions do you ask? If the interviewer is disrespectful or insensitive towards the participant, right? The breach of confidentiality, privacy, or anonymity of the participant. Okay, it's just like that, right? A therapist cannot go back and talk about their patients. A doctor cannot go back and discuss their patients, right? Ideal situation is that. Okay, that's your ethical. Similarly, we cannot go back and talk about our participants in research. You may generically say, you know what, this is what I have observed, but you cannot take names, you cannot say where they live, and you cannot say what they do. Okay, undue pressure to participate or continue. A lot of times when you do field work, especially in social sciences, your participants may midway decide to discontinue, and you will have to respect that stance of your participants. You cannot force your participants to participate. You cannot tell them that they have to do it, otherwise there would be adverse effects. Okay, a lot of times participants go through the repercussion or the fear of the repercussion due to the participation. What if something happens to me? In such scenarios, you have to see if you can protect your participants. If you cannot, please be honest with them and tell them that there's only so much you can do, and they have to decide if they want to participate or they do not want to participate in the study. Right? A lot of sensitive information, for example, from social sciences, would be on violence, on health, on sexual health, on income, assets and wealth, child labor. Okay, vulnerable population, religious and caste minorities, sexual minorities. Okay, all of this is sensitive information. As a researcher, you have to be very, very open, very, very understanding on how are you using this data. The next thing is context specific. Also understand how is your data context specific. For example, if I'm studying water supply, if I'm studying consumption, if I'm studying single-use plastic usage, right, during this pandemic time, it has increased. Then how does the solid waste management policy, which is being reviewed currently, how does it impact the usage of single-use plastic, right? So you have to understand things in context when, as a researcher, you're studying, you're doing surveys, Okay, and all that is also ethical. You cannot assume something, or you cannot have an idealistic perception of something and then collect data accordingly. You will have to collect data and present data as you get them. Okay, now what is the complexity of it? There's a lot of advancement in medical science, right? And today it has opened up possibilities that were not there previously. And because of which, when you look at medical experiments, when you look at conventional drug trials and experimental treatments, you see that they have actually improved over the years. And that's why, Sharmishtha, the entire thing of how the code of conduct has to adapt over time. Yeah, the globalization of research. Okay, so you could have local ethics committees, but at the same time, you will have global committees. So you will have to find a way as a researcher to match the ethical expectations of both the local committees of the organizations or institutions they're working with and the global ethics. Okay, institutions which specialize in experiments on animals will have their own code of ethics. Experiments which look at minorities, okay, institutions which study minorities, developmental studies on minorities, they will have their own code of ethics. So as researchers, you will have to understand in your area of work, are there specific code of ethics that we need to follow? Okay, a lot of times today with the scientific specialization, we are able to assess a lot of work that's coming out. We are able to understand it from different perspectives, right? But we did not have that bandwidth a couple of years back. So the code of ethics, while it is there from 1947, it has been adapted and it has changed over time. But then there are some behaviors which are considered misconduct in research, okay? Archana, that's very interesting. When you're working with labors, whether you have to give money or not, I would actually like to understand what was your final decision. Did you actually give them money for participating in the research or you did not? Management did not agree. I think that's a good stance to take, Archana, because when you give people money, you really are not sure of what kind of data they're going to give you, right? And especially if it's at the beginning of the survey, it can be very, very problematic. Maybe at the end of it, it's the same thing. Like we as researchers, one of the things that would happen when I worked in rural areas is people would, you know, after a survey, they would just feel happy and they would give us, you know, somebody once gave us a big thing of, what's that called? A plantain, okay? Because they had a, you know, plantain farm. And we were not sure if we should take it. And then somebody said, it's just bananas. And I said, no, but you know, I'm not sure if we can take it from them because we are setting a precedence that we are okay taking gifts from participants in research. And then they said, okay, ma'am, why don't you, you know, eat a banana after lunch and at least they'll feel happy. So we did that. We did not take back everything. We gave it back to them. We thanked them. And we just had them. So these are small behaviors. I cannot put them on a presentation and say, this is how you have to behave. You will have to decide based on the situation, how do we look at it, right? But the whole idea is a lot of times human relationships are very complex. The entire idea of building rapport in social science research is something that every researcher has to build. It's a skill to be able to build rapport with your participants. So you'll also have to see where are you saying no and how is that no impacting them. Right, but yeah, the entire thing of money, at least in Indian setup, what I have understood is it doesn't really work. I will not be able to comment on an international scenario, but from an Indian setup, social science research, what I have understood is don't give money to participants. It's okay to arrange for some snacks, get them to come together in the community hall in a village, get them to talk, share things, it's okay. Yeah, hospitality is all right, but monetary exchange can be very, very complicated. But what are the misconducts? Unacceptable conduct, right? Any form of fabrication, falsification of data. I'll talk about that in a while again. Financial things, misusing research funds, non-disclosing a conflict of interest, right? Inappropriate personal behavior, okay? Plagiarism, taking undue credit, not giving credit. All these are misconducts, okay? In research. But when we look at unethical practices, okay, to avoid while publishing research, these are the few things that you have to keep in mind. Yes, there is, Okay, I'm just going to monetary benefit be given as the end of research as a token of appreciation. Amit, it also depends on how large your sample is. How are you giving that monetary benefit? It's like I said, it's complicated. There is no easy answer. Somebody will come back to you and said, I answered it faster. Why are you giving him and me the same amount of money? How will you answer questions like that? It becomes very, very difficult. Or my family has five people. I have answered the survey for five people. Their family has only two people. How do you then? Money is very complicated as a benefit at the end of research. Archana, that can be hard when they don't want unions being formed. Yeah, that can be very, very hard. That's a completely different thing. I mean, if you work with trade unions and you work with laborers, you will have to learn how to balance out that equation, making sure that everybody's interest is met, you know, and not harming anybody. Is it a cultural connotation how offering money can be considered rude or treating one as poor? It is. It is. And it's often seen that, interestingly, Janet, one of the things that I have read and I have also come across is people in rural areas will not like to take money. Okay, because there's a lot of pride in where they come from and how they are doing. Okay, so they will share their basic daily meal with you if you're on a survey in smaller villages. At least this is what I have observed. And they will do that very proudly. Interestingly, I have also noticed that it's easier, okay? I'm not generalizing, but I've seen and I've heard from other researchers that at times maybe monetary benefits work in other places. But in a rural place, I personally have seen that people are not really lured by rural thing. I don't know if anybody else has a similar experience. It's completely from my experience, Janet, that I'm sharing. So they wouldn't want to be. I mean, they could be very poor economically, but they wouldn't want that to be a guiding force to us giving them money. Travel allowance is ethical, Kankan. You should take travel allowance for your studies. That's part of your research thing. Why someone is conducting a research is a question of ethics, Jovi. That's why you will have to make sure your why meets all the research paradigms. Duplicate submission, same as self-plagiarism. Yes, Sharmishta, I'm going to talk about that in a while. Okay. So let us look at what is duplicate submission. It's basically publishing in identical journals with acknowledgement, but it's still your own work, which you're publishing in multiple journals. That's duplicate submission. And that's unethical. Falsification or fabrication of data. Falsification is what? You're manipulating the method that has been used in research or the key findings. Fabrication is you're falsely recording fictitious data when there is no data. So I've got only 200 data, but I make it 260 because it sounds better. That's fabrication. Falsification is where I manipulated the method. So I'm supposed to be doing observation in a particular way, but I've not followed all the dictums or the tenets of observation technique. That's falsification of data. Plagiarism, we all know what it is, right? Copying data, not giving credit. Authorship conflict, not giving someone due credit. Somebody who's worked with you on your paper, but you do not give them authorship credit. Conflict of interest, where the author of the research study could have a personal consideration to do the research. Okay, and then there's a conflict of interest, especially because it will impact how you look at your research study and how you look at the problem definition and the solution. Yes, self-citation, Shruti, the idea is not about it being unethical, but if a person, like a lot of times we'll come across researchers who may have had one main paper, and then they take parts of that main paper, and then they keep citing it in their later papers, okay? And obviously, it is because it increases the citation count, but at a point of time, you see that a lot of it is like duplicate submissions and publications. Like I have come across papers where paragraphs are same, and these are in international journals also. So the same author over 15, 20 years has published how many ever papers, a large chunk of a particular paper is common across. Okay, so that's actually unethical behavior. Okay. All right, let us now look at the case study that we have shared with all of you. Okay. All right, all of you have a Word document that was shared on chat. I want you all to quickly read the case study that's there, and then I'm going to open the floor for question. Yes, Akshana, that happens. And in cases like that, that's where you need a panel to study. So you need people who do not have direct stake in the results of the study.
The link to the document was shared in the chat box and also in WhatsApp.
Yeah.
So
just share it once again, Meera.
Yeah, sure.
Lovely. That's an interesting question. If you're doing a research and a story of a case or a village, you will have to give due credit where it is, but you will have to ask your participants if they are okay with their actual names being mentioned or if they would like to have a pseudonym, right? So lovely. That's a very case-to-case thing on ethics that you will have to take. Thank you, Ashwini, for sharing that. All right, participants, open up. It's a small case study. Have you all read the case? Shambhalaji, it depends on the kind of study it is to talk about medical health for post-experiment. But yes, participants have to fill a consent and participants have to understand, they have to be told if there is some, if it's an experiment where, oh, about this case study? No, this case study, that's the only information I have here to give you. Okay. All right. Another minute, and then I'll ask the questions that I have. You present a paper in a conference, but it's not published. Can you publish the paper in another journal? You can publish it, but obviously if it's a different journal, you will have different rules and regulations and the way to publish that. Yes, Shruti, these are the things that we will have to discuss. This is a study from about 20, 30 years back, the case study was written. So we'll have to also look at it from that perspective. Okay, so let's look at a couple of questions here. Okay, is the research important enough to justify subjecting the women to the discomfort, inconvenience, and risk? Participants, you can either unmute yourself and speak, or you can put your responses on chat. Okay. Yeah, there are a lot of you. There are a lot of you who say that it is okay because the research is important enough, and you know, so it is okay if the women go through discomfort, inconvenience, and risk. What you have to remember here is simple. As long as the women have consented and understood all the expectations, right, including the one where they cannot get pregnant for 3 years after the study, as long as the woman is consented to it, it is okay. And it justifies the end. Okay, the next thing, what is the concern about the quality of the consent? I think, Shruti, you kind of began talking about it. What is the concern about the quality of the consent? Some of you are saying no, okay? Yeah, what is the concern? It may be done for money, okay? Do you think they have been given all information for them to consent? Okay, financial incentive could be the biggest thing. People could be doing it under family pressure. Okay. Okay. The data confidentiality has to be very, very stringent in studies like this. Obviously, the entire questions on the pregnancy aspect, right, where they cannot be pregnant and during the course of the study, of course, and they cannot be pregnant for a couple of years after that. Okay. Again, it has to be something where the consent is complete, where the participants know exactly what they're getting into. They understand the risks that are involved, right? Yes, 20 to 40 years could be. We could imagine that people will take independent decisions, but unfortunately, maybe it's not that simple. Participants should remember this for 3 years, okay? Okay, I had another point which said attention to gender issues. Okay. Single people have been segregated who could be more vulnerable. Yes, that's possible. That is possible, yeah. Okay. Is it possible for a woman to validly consent to be in the study? The study does not, yes, Sharanya, the study does not talk about long-term this. Looks very normative. Yes, Victor, it does. Yes. Again, there's a cultural component, right? A lot of you would be relating to it from a cultural perspective for India, for Asian countries, the entire pregnancy thing could be a big thing. But in some other countries, in individualistic cultures, it may not be that big a deal. So there is always a cultural component in studies like this. Now, do you have any objections to this research? And what would you do differently? Anybody? What would you do differently? If there is one condition, terms and condition that you would add to the study, what would that be? Anybody? One terms and condition that you would add to the study. Some points have not been delineated. Okay, the long-term effects have to be spoken about. More details have to be given. Okay. They should be allowed to leave at any point of time, yeah, but they have to pay a fine, right? We'll do a workshop. That's an interesting thing, Shamanija, to actually explain to them what it means before you get a final consent. There has to be a limited liability. There should be medical support, yeah. All of these things that you're saying, would take care of the ethical components of the study. Legal support, medical support, yeah? Interact with friends and family, okay? Okay, all right, All right. So all of those concerns, right? So if you look at it, it's a basic case study, right? Now, this case study could as well be very, very hypothetical by nature. But the whole idea is you do see that unless there is complete consent, unless there is all information about short-term and long-term impact, unless there is legal and medical support studies like this, the end may not justify the means or the way they're going about it. Victor, you're saying they should include women who identify themselves from the non-normative gender. Yes, but again, this case study is written about 15, 20 years back. And that's why maybe it doesn't consider the gender spectrum. Yes, that's a fantastic idea. I think Shamanija, you spoke about, you know, having a discussion with them, having a workshop. Janet, you're talking about a trial period where the mental and physical health can be assessed. That's also a fantastic idea, right? Which will also give you more credibility to the study, right? To understand that are these participants actually ready? Because it's a very different thing to fill a consent form, right? Send across an email and say, you know what, I want to, or a letter and say, post something and say, I'm ready to participate in the study. But the whole idea is, do people understand the implications of participating in long-term studies, right? That would definitely be a couple of points that we should look at. I did have a lot of questions, like, you know, what was the quality of consent? Was it enough? Were there enough questions? Okay. The target population, would you consider this target population as being disadvantaged? Single women who may need the money at a particular point of time. Okay. Is it okay by penalizing them if they leave the research midway? Is it a coercive threat that we are looking at? Right. That is something that we need to ask ourselves. And like you all said, is it reasonable to ask women to avoid pregnancy for 3 years? Okay, so that case study was just a brief understanding of how research can be very, very complicated. Okay, and at the same time, if you actually put a lot of thought, you write a detailed consent form, you explain the impact of a study, you explain, you know, the terms and conditions from different branches, right? Like a legal aspect, the medical aspect, okay, the social aspect, the interpersonal aspect. Just the legal and the medical support is not enough. A lot of them may need counseling later, right? A lot of them may actually not be able to cope with the demand of the study. Yeah, like you said, Anna, it doesn't explain the exit option, right? Apart from just saying that they could be penalized if they leave, how will they get support if they leave something like that? Is there a support system that's there for them? Right? These are all things that have to be explained in studies like this. Okay, from there, we'll move on to the second component for today, which is a little more detail on plagiarism and its impact and why is plagiarism an unethical practice. Okay, so it is basically taking ideas or words from a source without giving them credit. Very simply put, that's plagiarism. Okay, it is like theft and it's an academic crime, very simply put. Okay, because in academic work, ideas and words are private property of a person who first thought or wrote them. And that's why citations become important, okay? And we have to know how to prevent plagiarism. Now, from students, what is the expectation? The fact that you all have read principal experts on a subject and you give citations on their work. You are able to also explain those ideas in your own words and you are able to present original conclusions. This is basic expectation that anybody has from research students. Why should you avoid plagiarism? Because the copying somebody else's work will not help you develop your own understanding, okay? Also to know that there are rules of academic community. Every community has its own rules and regulations, okay? And the academic community has very stringent rules of plagiarism. It is easily detected, right? Today we have softwares, okay? The number of softwares that are available where I can put in a document and immediately it will tell me how much percentage of the document is plagiarized. It's very, very simple to check plagiarism, okay? And academically, for all of you who are undergrad, postgrad students here, you can actually fail a course if your college is very strict about plagiarism, right? Again, different colleges have different percentage. Across India, different universities have different percentages of plagiarism that's accepted at a master's level and at a PhD level, okay? So I don't know how many of you have checked with your respective departments, but is there a percentage of plagiarism that's there? I mean, which says that you can only plagiarize 7 to 10% of the document can be plagiarized. Do you have numbers like that? Anybody? Do you have numbers like that? 10%? 10%? Okay. The study, Shamsham Rinda, it's invasive enough to be debarred. Yeah. Okay, 10%. UGC says 10%. Okay. Okay. While UGC says 7%, 10%, there are, it differs for different, it could differ for different chapters. It differs for different universities. It differs whether you are at master's level. VTU is up to 25%. Wow. Okay. So it is complicated, but yes, Zelchka, also different softwares give you different results. So you should try it across softwares. But the best idea is to find out which is the software your university is using, because that's the norm that they are going to follow. So that's one way for students to understand this. But at the end of the day, plagiarism is unethical. Okay. A lot of my slides where I've taken content everywhere in my notes segment, I will usually have a reference, or I'll put it on the slide and I put them in my reference points for you all to look back, because that's the original things, right? And it's important for you all to make a note of where you take your content from. Okay, it's important to acknowledge your sources. Okay, now when you do summary and citation, there's one way to talk about it. We also spoke about if there's quotation and citation, how do you actually write it? Yeah, in some universities, citation, referencing, and ethics carries more weightage, yes. Okay, Archana. That's interesting, definitely. Okay, now let's look at this. This is your exercise 2 in your handbook. Okay, tell me which is plagiarism. Okay, copying a paragraph but changing a few words and giving a citation, is it plagiarism? It is still, right? Yes. The second one, cutting and pasting a short article with no citation, is plagiarism? Okay. Third one, taking two paragraphs from a classmate's essay without citation. Plagiarism. Taking a graph from a textbook and giving the source. Is it plagiarism? It's not. Okay. Taking a quotation from a source, giving a citation, but not using quotation marks. Unfortunately, it becomes plagiarism, because when you take a quotation, you will have to give the quotation marks. Using something that you think of as a general knowledge. Example, large areas of rainforest have been cut down in recent years, but there's no citation from it. It is general knowledge. So is it plagiarism? It's not plagiarism. Using a paragraph from an essay that you wrote and you had marked the previous semester without citation. Is it plagiarism? Is it self-plagiarism? It's a little confusing, isn't it? A lot of you are saying, yes, it is. Without citation, yes, it's problematic. Okay. Using the results of your own research from a survey without citation, is it plagiarism? It may not be plagiarism, but it's wrong because you have to give citations. Okay. Discussing an essay topic with a group of classmates and using some of their ideas in their work without giving them credit, is it plagiarism? Yes. Okay. Giving a citation for some information, but misspelling the author's name. It's theft. Giving citation, but misspelling the author's name. Yeah, it's an error. It's not plagiarism, but it's an error. You can't make errors like that. Okay, situation 10, when the author's name is misspelled, is actually technically plagiarism, but it's actually carelessness more than being plagiarism. Situation 9, your teacher may have encouraged you to discuss the topic in groups and then write an essay, then it's not a plagiarism. But if it is something wherein you discuss to get the benefit of the entire situation, but then you didn't give them credit, then it's plagiarism. Situation 7 is self-plagiarism. Situation 6, how do you decide what is general or common knowledge? Right? But it's not a good excuse. If it's something that is published and you can give a citation, you should give a citation for it. This is something that's important. Now, quotation should not be overused. So it's important that you learn how to paraphrase and summarize. Okay. Now, paraphrasing is about rewriting a particular text so that the language is substantially different when the content stays the same. Summarizing is reducing the length of a text, but retaining the main points. That's the difference between paraphrasing. Paraphrasing is rewriting. Okay. Summarizing is reducing the length, retaining the main points. And often we use both of them together and we use both of them interchangeably. Have we understood paraphrasing? And summarizing, have we understood? Okay. All right. Okay, now look at this exercise in your handbook. Okay, this is your main paragraph here. The railway manias in 1830, there were a few dozen miles of railways in all the world, chiefly consisting of the line from Liverpool to Manchester. By 1840, there were over 4,500 miles. By 1850, 23,500. Okay. Most of them were projected in a few bursts of speculative frenzy known as the railway manias of 1835 to 7 and especially in 1844 to 7. Most of them built in large part with British capital, British iron, machines and know-how. These investment booms appear irrational because in fact few railways were much more profitable to the investor than other forms of enterprise. Most yielded quite modest profits and many none at all. In 1855, the average interest on capital sunk in British railways was a mere 3.7%. Okay, now read this, look at the five paragraphs below and decide which is plagiarized, which is paraphrased, and which is summarized and which is acceptable. Okay, I'm going to open that Word document. With summarizing, you will have to still give citations, Pandita. The intent is same, the language is different, that's paraphrasing, Amit, but you will still have to give citation so that it's not plagiarism. Otherwise, it is plagiarism. Okay, let us. Let me open the Word document. The first paragraph, is it paraphrasing or is it summarizing? The first paragraph. The first point, is it paraphrasing or summarizing? It is a summary, okay? The second one, point B. Point B is an attempt to paraphrase, but there's enough material that they have plagiarized. Point C. Shaujuddin, if you're changing few words but giving citation, it is still plagiarism because you'll have to change the entire way it's written. Point three is more paraphrasing. Okay, point four. Point four is more like a summary just on the ending. Some of you, it's a bad summary. Yes, it's a bad summary. Point four does not really give you much information. The fifth one. The fifth one has not given you data, has not given you any citation, but it's just given a line which talks about what the previous paragraph is. It's again a bad summary with no citation. Okay, so what you have to understand is both paraphrasing and summarizing is a skill and you should be able to do it well, right? Paraphrasing, where you're changing the way the language is, but you're keeping the main content there, okay? You still have to give a citation. Summary, if it's a large thing, but you are putting everything together in 2-3 lines, you may not have to give the citation at the end of it, but you will have to summarize it in your own language completely. Yeah, the last one is a bad summary again. Yeah. Okay. Now I'm going to open the floor for discussion with a particular question that I have here. Okay. I'm going to give you all about 5 minutes to think about this. And then we're going to open the floor for discussion. Meera, is that okay? Before we take questions for today. I want you all to share an ethics dilemma that you have faced and how did you solve it? That's our discussion for today. Okay, I'm going to stop sharing my screen because I want you all to come on video when you're speaking. Okay. All right. So I want you all to share an ethics dilemma. Okay. And how did you solve it? And today what we'll do is I will not give you the solution. but I want other participants, okay? If you have an alternate solution to that ethics dilemma that one of your classmates have faced, how would you solve it? All right? So it's time to give each other your ideas. It's enough just listening to us. Okay, it's time to give each other your ideas and also to present different perspectives. Okay, who would like to open the floor to discussion? Who would like to take the first thing? Shamanuja, you would? Yeah, please. Meera, can you just unmute him?
You are unmuted, Shamanuja.
See, in my case, I think I have said earlier also, I'm doing a digital ethnographic research using on Twitter. So while I was asked to do some, you know, some of the ethical things I did, and every now and then I would come with new challenges, again new challenges. And because the medium itself was changing, the government policies were changing, and you know, I thought maybe I'll keep. The way I solved is actually it is not that I found a magic formula, but I found a very conceptual, nice framework. I chanced upon an article by Annette Markham called Ethics as Method and Method as Ethics. That kind of opened, and especially in the CEC herself is a great digital ethnographer. So it is not that there was some magic formula, but by changing the entire and accepting that you keep evaluating, I thought maybe it is a good practice. So I am now trying to follow that.
Okay. Shamanuja, can you also share with us that resource that you spoke about?
That article?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you can just share the link on the WhatsApp chat, I think all of us can benefit from it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Any thoughts on that? Any thoughts on what Shamanuja shared? Anybody? So you have found a solution. You have found something like a guiding principle which tells you how to deal with, you know, your ethical challenges.
I find answer to the specific questions. But now it is not that, you know, earlier I was very defensive. I was apologetic that I am changing it again and again. Now I do that with a lot of confidence and good feeling that it is a good practice to do.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much, Shamanuja. Meera also put this link on the WhatsApp group maybe. The article link the Shaman just sent us? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. Thank you. Anybody else? Ethical dilemma that you all have faced? Janet, can you also speak up, please? I know you put it on chat. Do you want me to read it out or would you like to share?
Janet, we are trying to unmute you. Okay, she wants me to read it, so I'll just go ahead and read it.
Yeah, please.
Just a second. My experiences keep getting plagiarized because they aren't research papers. I did have a company try to stop my work by claiming that I plagiarized them. They stole my write-up as well. Since experiences cannot be quoted or tracked easily, I resorted to building more PR around my projects. That allowed a trackable presence around my work. If my work gets plagiarized, it's seen as a copy instead of as an original idea.
Okay. Now, Janet, that you know, because of the fact that there's so much information available online, a lot of times people don't understand that you just can't pick somebody's experience and write about it without giving them credit. I think, you know, and especially since you are looking at talking about or writing about your experiences, what you've done is okay, building PR around your experience. But the other thing is also if you can collate it, right? Do a blog, have a website of your own. And, you know, so that you mentioned, right? It's your copyrighted work. Okay. And anybody who uses that, they will have to give you credit. So that's one way to take care of it, right? No easy solution because it's a world where information is easily available. A lot of times people don't think about giving credit, but one way to protect your own work is to, you know, put it on your blog, put it on your website and then be hawk-eyed to make sure that nobody's taking the information from you without giving you credit. That's one way, but only you know your experience. So only the way you write it or you present a timeline of your experience will be unique and different. So that's one way to look at it. But yeah, one way to protect is that. I hope that helps. It is stressful. Yes, it is. No, you shouldn't let go. You have complete right on that work. It's your original work. You have to just be hawk-eyed and make sure nobody takes credit for it. Okay, there's one more Meera in the chat.
Just yeah, Rajkumar, do you want to speak? Trying to unmute you, Raj. Okay, maybe I'll just read that one as well. Ma'am, I'm not a scholar, but I wrote a paper for a seminar. I wrote by picking sentences from many different textbooks and made congruent essay conveying my ideas. I didn't summarize or paraphrase, I just knitted sentences. Is this plagiarism? I cited all my resources in the end. Kindly help.
Unknowingly, you may have plagiarized, unfortunately, if you have taken sentences and stitched them together. Because then you will also notice that different people have different writing styles. So you may have moved from active to passive, in terms of the voice, you may have moved in terms of the tenses. So it's best that when you read, understand and summarize that and paraphrase, that's the best way to write. Especially if you're looking at submitting it for a seminar or a conference. Right? So unknowingly, you may have plagiarized even if you give your resources in the end, unless you give citations after every paragraph or after every concept. Okay. All right, anybody else?
Ma'am, I had two questions.
Yeah.
So one of the problems I have grappled with is when I'm writing a research paper, since my subject is literature, and I will be doing a lot of discourse analysis and also narrative analysis, it is very, I find it necessary to quote large chunks of literature from so that I can analyze it. Because the narrative analysis is essentially that. So when I send a paper across, UGC would have its own standards of how much plagiarism is allowed and so forth. And if I do not quote a paragraph, I will not be able to analyze it.
So
then as a literature student, I find it very difficult because if I don't make enough quotations, then my paper doesn't stand because I'm not giving enough examples to exemplify the idea that I'm trying to talk about. Yeah. On the other hand, if I quote extensively, then it goes beyond the plagiarism level that UGC would approve.
Oh, okay.
So what would somebody do in such a circumstance?
Okay, so one of the things that happens is you are putting it in quotes and you are putting it if they have a, you have right. to either italicize it or, and you have to give the citation at the background, right? As long as you're doing that, you're taking care of the plagiarism component. But a lot of times what I have also seen is that, when people have to quote large paragraphs, especially in narrative analysis in literature, they give the starting of the paragraph, then there's a little dot, 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 and then they give the last part of the paragraph.
Right.
And then in a footnote, they will probably put it in the appendix or give the actual resource.
Right.
So that could be one way to solve if you have large, but I understand if you're summarizing a narrative, you will have to give the original and then talk about it.
Right. So not only when we are summarizing, especially when we are talking about the writing style, for instance, or the words used, it becomes necessary that we put the entire paragraph so that you know what we are talking about.
Correct. So like I said, it's... It's a very devil in the deep sea kind of component, right? I mean, how do you decide? But then, you'll have to, as long as, my thing would be this, as long as you put it in quotation marks and you follow the, I don't know if UGC follows the italicized version, follow that, then it cannot be considered as plagiarism. So a lot of people, when they check for plagiarism, what they also do is they remove or they retract these components of the paper, and then they check for plagiarism for only the original component that you've written. So that's one way to navigate it. But the other thing is also check with your guide. But I have seen literature students where they put the dot, 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 and then they give a footnote to say, this is the original. And especially if the original text is, say, 300 words, which is almost a page. right? And to discuss the narrative style and the terminologies that have been used by the author, and you're comparing that terminology which has grown over a particular set of years in literature, a lot of them put that in appendices. But you can't then have multiple appendices, right? So you will have to find a balance in your writing and see how that fits in. But for papers that you submit to conferences, you will have to lessen the number of original quotations that you can use, especially if plagiarism check has a particular percentage that they're looking at.
So I see two more hands up. So we'll take those questions. Kanchan, trying to unmute you, please speak up.
Yes, I had two questions. First question for Meera, you also, because I'm also from literature. The problem sometimes, so there is a limit, I think, when there is a software, that plagiarism software. Some of my colleagues told me that if you are doing your final dissertation, even if you once put your part of research in that, and if you put it later, it will also consider that part to be plagiarized. And if you have given quotations, there is a limit. And when even if you have given citations, it exceeds that limit, then it considers that as a plagiarism as well. Even the quotation, even if you have given the citations. So it depends on the software that particular institution is using. Yeah. Then second question was, there are two generic questions about literature. I was speaking to a philosopher. When I just told him I'm doing research on speeches of Vivekananda and Jiddu Krishnamurti, the philosopher was like, he used that word. He said that's unethical because in literature, you really don't have the boundaries. So you can pick up any damn topic and quote it as a literature because and start working. So I don't know. It is not directly related to the ethics. But of course, there are certain disciplines where the boundaries are, I think, blurred. So how can we call it unethical?
Yeah. So Kanchan, I think it's very interesting. Now, if you bring in how Jiddu Krishnamurti looks at pedagogy of learning, it's very different, right? But if we are looking at this from a perspective of being a research student who has to get into conferences, who has to look at it, unfortunately, you will have to quote, you will have to cite. Yeah. So you will have to then find a way across those rules and regulations of UGC to see how much can I quote so that my paper is strong enough and there is enough content in it for it to go into a conference, right? So obviously in literature, those boundaries are very, very hazy at times and it's very difficult, but ethics has never been an easy topic to talk about, right? So that is something that you all have to learn to navigate, unfortunately. And different softwares do give it differently, do have different terms and conditions. So you'll have to understand what is the software looking at. Right. For example, the online plagiarism softwares, they also tell you, so even if you've given a quotation, they will pick that up. If it's your own writing and you've written the same thing twice, they'll pick it up. So you will have to understand which software to use and what does the software actually do. That's where universities give you a leeway. So if they say 10% plagiarism, then they'll say, okay, plus or minus so much, given the software is going to treat your document like this and depending on the discipline. So that some of them do. Everybody's trying to find a way. But there's no compromising with ethics. Yeah, the next one. Anybody else, give me a dilemma. Don't ask me questions. I want you all to share experiences. The university, yes, Ashwin, does list the software tool to be used. And you have to, unfortunately, abide by those rules and regulations. Yeah. Anybody else? People who are field researchers.
Ma'am, actually, even I have a doubt.
Okay.
Yeah, ma'am, the case study that you had shared, they were talking about penalizing the participants in case they leave halfway. Do you think it is ethical to do that? Because here, when we do our studies here in NIMHANS, we usually give the participant the leverage to leave whenever they feel like.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't be ethical to force the participant to stay back and in case the participant wants to leave and then you penalize them, that will be unethical, no?
Of course. Yes, Kankan, it is unethical. That was one of the questions in the discussion, that it is unethical to penalize them if they have to leave.
And one more thing is that the TA that we are paying to the patients, the participants, like when they come for a study, like for some assessments or something, like you said, monetary exchange should not be done. It is preferable not to do monetary exchange. Is the TA also considered to be a monetary exchange? because we are giving them money for travel allowance, like auto charge or bus charge.
No, that is all right. That is all right. But what I'm saying is, it shouldn't look like, so you'll have to clearly tell them why you're giving them that TA.
Yeah.
It shouldn't look like I'm giving you 1,000 rupees for participating. It should say, okay, I'm giving you so much. And I'm sure you have a form which they sign where they say that I've been given this money for TA. So it has to be clearly stated why is it for.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm saying that you have these participants who are coming to participate in your study. And, you know, you are obviously giving them that benefit, or say it's been a long day and you're arranging lunch for them. There's no problem with that. Or you are saying you're giving your 20 participants who are waiting and you're doing the study and you give them, say, 50 rupees, 100 rupees to go and have lunch in your Nimhans canteen. Correct? It's absolutely okay because that's part of the research expense. But it shouldn't be that that money is motivating them to be a part of the study. So the motivation and the consent should not be associated with that monetary benefit is what I'm saying.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank okay. you. Yeah. Sukanya, I think you wanted to say something. Sukanya had messaged a while back.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Mine is actually field-oriented research. So
okay.
in the acknowledgement part, I used mm-hmm. to put the informant list, like where I have collected this data and from which is the settlement name also.
Okay.
I used to feel that whether should I put that on, is it okay to put the name informant list?
Okay. So Kanya, as long as you have consent of the participants, you can put it in your acknowledgement.
Yeah, okay.
So now the settlement that you're studying, say the participants say, we don't want to be mentioned. Then you will only approximately mention the geographical area. Correct? And maybe the population or the demography and nothing more. Correct? Yeah. So you will take away information which can directly point to the place, but give enough information for somebody to understand that yours is legitimate data.
Yeah, okay. So settlement name itself enough, isn't it?
It is, but as long as you have consent, as long as those people participating know that you're talking about it.
Yeah, okay.
So you don't go and tell them this is anonymous survey, but later go and publish the name of the settlement. Then it's unethical.
Yeah, okay.
As long as your participants are okay with being mentioned and they're okay saying that this settlement has been studied, then it's all right. There's nothing wrong.
Yeah. I have one more question.
Yeah.
While I'm going to fieldwork, they actually expect some money from the researcher. So for some they can give, but for the students and all, they can afford to give money. So if I'm paying to them, in future they will expect from other researchers also. So I feel like what should I do? Should I give money or it will cause problem to some other researcher?
See, like I always say, but again, it's a very personal stance. Money is very complicated, Sukanya. You may as well buy them maybe a packet of biscuits or some cake or something like that, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
as
a thank you token, you can do that. But money can be very, very complicated, Sukanya. And you're setting an expectation that every researcher who comes there is going to pay them money.
Yeah.
Right? So they may start fabricating and falsifying data because they think they're going to get money at the end of being a part of the research study. So that's a very difficult precedent you're setting.
Yeah.
So you have to, as a researcher, also understand what kind of expectation are you setting in the future for them?
Yeah. Okay.
So see, unless there are some studies wherein there are surveys, obviously there are corporate studies. I think that was one of the questions that came up, wherein they study a particular settlement, they could be studying a particular community, and they could be giving benefits to the community. Okay.
Yeah.
And that could be seen as long as the community is aware of why the benefits are coming to them, how they have participated in the study, and the data that they have given is actual and the data is not fabricated.
Yeah.
Then it's okay. So it could be that a corporate is doing, you know, they could be doing a CSR thing where they are, say, studying rainwater harvesting. And because a particular community has participated in the survey, the corporate is also giving them a particular amount of money to set up a rainwater harvesting plant.
Yeah.
Or a system.
Yeah.
That kind of a thing, as long as everything is on paper, everything is clearly stated, it is all right.
Yeah.
But if things are not stated and it's being done in a very hush-hush manner, then it's unethical by nature.
Okay.
Right? Because a corporate has to be able to, in their CSR report, actually write down how much percentage of their annual profits have they spent, what is their goal of CSR, what is their target, what are their activities, how many people from the organization has been involved, how many man-hours has been involved. So an actual CSR report of an organization has to have all these details ideally.
Yeah.
So Okay. All right.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
Ma'am, we have another question from somebody who does not want to reveal the name. I'll
read it. Yeah, sure.
What to do if your department is not registering your research for ethical committee clearance, as they believe the work could be done without it, though you believe in the opposite. And because of it, you don't want to start with your data collection.
Can you repeat the question once more?
Yeah, so what to do if your department is not registering your research for ethical committee clearance, as they believe the work could be done without it, without the ethical committee clearance.
Don't do it. You'll be in trouble later. Your work has to be cleared by the committee. At all level, you have to have all clearance for your research work. I'm not sure which university it is. It can be very, very problematic later on. And there can be legal implications on it. So whoever it is, whoever's written anonymously, please make sure you have your research committee has to clear your project proposal. Okay, if they give you suggestions, you'll have to incorporate those suggestions. You do not want to ruffle the wrong feathers. I think everybody who's a current doctoral student will tell you that you do not go ahead without complete permissions. It's not done. I think some of you mentioned that you can give books. Yes, you can also give books if you're working with young people and students.
And Madan asks, sometimes the conclusion is contradictory to social norms, so should it be published?
Why not? If it's data-based, why not? I mean, the idea of doing research is to find something that's not there, right? And you don't have to always find things that, if you're only doing research to ascertain what is already being told, then there's nothing new really. You will have to have contradictory viewpoints also come out. As long as you have citations, as long as you have actual data to prove it, it's okay. But again, your question is very complicated. I don't know what you mean is social norms. It's very vague. Okay.
So I think with that, we come to the end of the questions. Any more questions, anybody?
Anybody else wants to share a dilemma that you have faced and how you have solved it? Anybody wants to share? Nobody's faced any dilemma. That's fantastic. Wow. Okay. Rules of thumb to avoid close paraphrasing. Keep rereading it, Sharmishtha. That's the only way. You read it, make somebody else read it. Because a lot of times when you're writing it, you don't realize that you have actually plagiarized unknowingly. Because you've read it so many times, you've almost memorized it at a point. So you start writing like some of the authors you have read. And then it almost sounds like you're plagiarizing them. So you read it multiple times, you get somebody else to read. That's one rule of thumb to break that thing. And the more you read, and keep rewriting it in your own word.
I can see Shruti has raised her hand.
Yeah, Shruti, tell me. Ashwin, you have asked if it's education-based research for school students, ethical to give them chocolates as motivation. Ashwin, not at the beginning. Give it to them at the end as a thank you gift. Then it's okay.
Hi.
But yeah. Yeah, Shruti, ask me.
Yeah. So I have a couple of questions.
Yeah, sure.
First of all, the kind of work I'm doing, mm-hmm. and the literatures available and the research that's been available out there is like enormous. Like it's like 50, 100, thousands of works available over there. So when a certain facts or point, as you said, if I mention those and if I don't cite those, those are not plagiarism. But if we know that these are like a certain facts, and if we don't cite it, I just mentioned it in the paper, so that means it's not a plagiarism, right?
Okay, Shruti, if you're taking anything from anywhere else,
yeah,
another paper, another journal, another book, okay, you will have to cite it in the bracket. Citation is what? Yeah. Citation is the author name and the year.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, depending on whether you're giving a quotation, some people also give the page number. Again, it depends on which style are you following for referencing and citation. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Now, say you are rewriting the paragraph in your own word.
Yeah.
Okay.
No.
You're not directly taking it, but you've taken the idea. So it's still your referencing.
Yeah.
So at that point, maybe after every sentence, you don't have to cite, but the end of the large paragraph, you can cite together those 3-4 authors whose ideas you've taken together and paraphrased in that one paragraph.
Okay.
Does that help?
Yeah.
But you will have to, because that is going to be part of your reference list. So there are reviewers who will actually check back. At least I remember for my thesis work at ISC, I had an international reviewer and an Indian reviewer. The international reviewer had actually checked back and had actually, in a comment written that I have actually followed an author from their seminal paper to their latest publication and had kind of just stated that, do I realize I had followed that author so many times? And I did. So I responded back to that query saying that I know, and this author has published so many papers, but each paper has had maybe a new component, a new industry or a new country that the author had studied, and how that work had developed over 20 years. And I was actually able to follow that author's work. So there are reviewers who will actually go to that much detailing in your work and pick on things. It's possible the person did a random check. But at the end of the day, as a doctoral student, I had to be prepared to answer every question. And why is it that one particular author, I actually in my reference list have 10 papers of the same person? Okay. Oh. Right? So for your own thing, it's always better to, even if you're not directly quoting, it's always better to cite.
Okay.
And that's where your cue cards come in handy, people, when you do your literature review. Make your cue cards. Have cue cards, like I said, the table format of literature, either follow that table format or have cue cards and bundle them according thematically. Okay. So you know that when you have written that segment of your literature, you have cited everybody whom you have read.
Okay.
And that these are like little rules of thumb, but they really help in the long run when you've been reading for 4 years and then you have to put your thesis together.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
one more question is for in a paper, in one paragraph, for particularly the discussion part, so an author, when he she writing, so it will cite multiple papers and then come to a conclusion. So when I am paraphrasing or summarizing that particular paragraph where the author themselves have used lot of citations, so when I am doing it, should I only cite that particular paper or all the paper that fellow?
If you remember in the citation thing, there was something called citation within a citation. So you have the main author citation with that, whoever the main author has cited, you'll have to write that also.
That one, that's right.
Especially if it's an important work. You'll have to. Unless you're taking the paraphrase part from this particular author A, who has cited author B, C, D, then you don't have to. But if you're taking something wherein the B, C, D's work is very, very important, you will have to cite it.
Okay. If the author A has paraphrased this and I'm using that, so I don't have to.
Then you'll have to cite author A. But if the author A has taken a quotation or has constantly repeated B, C, D, you'll have to cite B, C, D at some point.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's what's the
question. See, there is no harm in over-citing. There's a problem in under-citing.
Okay. Yes.
So that's something you have to keep in mind. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes, Shyamanuja, synthesizing is much more difficult. It is. And synthesizing is a skill because you don't know where you're overdoing it or underdoing it. Online tools for paraphrasing? No. Write it on your own. Don't trust technology that much. Okay. Meera, one or two more? And we can...
Anonymous question.
Is
it okay to use someone else's bibliography for a different topic, like if you just go ahead and use somebody else's bibliography? I think the person means if you go ahead and take the citations, go back to the papers, cross-reference it and come back.
That is okay, but you can't copy somebody's bibliography. Look at somebody's bibliography, then go back to the original paper and then cite it. You can do that. Then that becomes your reference and not your bibliography. Remember that. Bibliography is a larger thing where you may not directly cite everything you have read. Bibliography is everything you have read. Reference is what you have actually cited in your work. That's where referencing and bibliography differ. Okay. We have a couple of more questions, Meera, here. I have a question where it's about power dynamics and press for time. I'm unable to scroll upwards. Give me a minute. Ashita, you have said that during master's thesis, you have to collect data from children with developmental psychopathology. The psychiatrist asked you to get your data by telling them it's a part of an assessment and not a separate study. That even though the psychiatrist may have been very good, Ashita, that's a little unethical to do. Okay, and obviously at times it can be difficult because the power dynamic is skewed, but I think you did a good call if you did not do that, because it's very, very problematic.
I think Ashwin Bittul also has a question.
Yeah.
Trying to unmute you. Okay, I'll read it.
Yeah, I'm looking at that. I'm looking at that, Meera. What do you do when research questions in PhD, after some time you find that somebody's done a research recently? Nothing, you continue with your question. And whatever is recently done, put that into your citation and references. You cannot keep changing it, right? I mean, if your country is different, then it's a different study altogether. Otherwise, you'll have to keep changing, because at the same time, a lot of people could be studying the same thing. Yeah. Sources who cite and pick up information from original source and cross-check. Janet, in some cases, you have to cite the paper and the original source. That's what I'm saying. If there's an original seminal paper that many people cite, you will have to also cite both of them. If you learn something from a workshop or a lecture, how do you acknowledge it? See if that person you were listening to, Kamlesh, has a paper or a publication from where you can cite them. That becomes important. Anybody else? What do you mean, Spandita? If not, then how? That's an incomplete portion of a paper published previously be used and cited. Yes, people do that.
Spandita, we are trying to. What is your question?
That's incomplete. I think we lost a part of the question.
Ma'am, can you see Abhishek Pandey's question?
Yeah, trade and cultural relationship with Central Asia. You can use oral history, but then you'll have to give your sources. Even your primary sources have to be. You'll have to write where you have got that from. So that's important.
So, all right. Okay. I think Mrudul also has a question. And
yeah, just, Mrudul. Okay.
Just wanted to mention that the attendance form has been shared. We will also be sharing it in the WhatsApp group. So please mention your attendance there.
Yeah. Mrudul, please ask your question.
Hello, ma'am. Actually, when I was asked to write a paper or something, I want to put my ideas on a paper, but I also try to search something on Google so that I can incorporate some ideas. I feel that they are on the same page of my idea, but should I do that? I don't want to take the whole sentences, but I want to take the idea. Should I do that or go with my own thing only?
Take the idea, rewrite it. That's paraphrasing.
Yeah, I know
but
that.
Give credit to wherever the original idea is coming from. It's important to give credit, Mridul. If it's not your own idea, okay? But if it's an original idea of somebody else, you will have to give credit on where you've got the idea from. It's like this. For example, you have motivation theory by Abraham Maslow. Over the years, multiple theorists have tweaked that motivation theory and spoken about different components. Okay, now I, as a researcher, I will have to cite the original Maslow theory. But if I have a new idea that's different, but I see some corporate has already done it, I will have to also cite that. Okay. It's important. So do it as much as you can with honesty. At times, we may miss out. However honest and ethical you are, people do miss out at times. But that kind of an honest mistake is okay. What I'm saying is don't do it on purpose.
No. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. You'll have to credit people for ideas, Mridul. There is no two ways about it. Okay.
Pandita has elaborated on her question. Mm. I mean that if you have participated in any workshop and the lecturer does not have an article on that particular topic, how should I acknowledge it?
Then just write about it, Pandita, and maybe in your acknowledgement or in your, at some point, maybe mentioned where you heard it. I mean, you could have, in your referencing segment at the end, you can also write a workshop and you can write the title and the date. You can maybe do that.
Trinath, please go ahead and ask a question.
Yeah, I think Amit and Aditi have a question about participants and ethics, where participants participate and then midway they leave it. Okay, now, who is that?
I'm Trinath, ma'am. I'm a research scholar in genetics department, NIMHANS.
Okay.
Two things I want to share. One is one of my colleagues from here, Kankan, mm-hmm. has asked about paying some monetary benefits to the participants. Usually we pay this monetary benefit to the participant so that because they are participating in our study, and this shouldn't burden them they shouldn't be spending anything for our project participation. So that is the purpose. We pay them TA and some food allowances if it takes a longer time to complete the whatever the assessments are there. And even here in NIMHANS, ethics are very strictly followed. And they encourage and they look also like whether we are paying any travel allowances or food allowances to the participants if the assessment is taking a longer period. This is one thing. And one more ethical dilemma what we faced is I'm working on a project and doing my PhD. So like for my PhD, the project is registered with Clinical Trial Registry India. Because it's a clinical trial. So, and with the same subjects, data, I'll be looking at different parameters, clinical parameters. So the dilemma was whether my PhD work should again be registered in Clinical Trial Registry India.
Okay.
So in one of the doctoral committee meeting, we decided on a safer side, let your PhD protocol also be registered in the CTRI. Yeah. So this was the
dilemma.
And yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Trinath, thank you for sharing that. But two things here, okay? These registration things, right? The rules keep changing, right? Recently, the clinical research community has to have a different registration compared to the other behavioral research community, correct? So whenever these rules and regulations change, it's always best to register with these committees and make sure that you're part of it and you get the approvals. There is no two way. It's always good because that's your research community and you will have to abide by the rules and regulations. The second thing is, I understand what you're talking about, NIMHANS. I did my master's in clinical psychology before I moved to industrial. So I did my internship at NIMHANS when I did my master's. And, for studies like that, wherein, like you're saying, right, you're giving food allowance, you're giving TA, as long as everything is documented and your participants know exactly what that money is given for, it is okay.
Yes, ma'am.
It's like this, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Exactly. So that's ethical. But it's like this. You're doing a study on alcoholism. At the end of it, you're giving the participant money. The participant is going to use it to drink.
Yes,
right? These are always ethical issues, right? When we study substance abuse behavior, for example. So in such cases, people don't give money, right? So again, it's very, very context driven. It's depending on the study that you're doing. And accordingly, you will have to decide. So if there's any form of monetary exchange in your research study, you will have to document exactly why it's happening, just the way you all are doing it at NIMHANS. But that has to be followed across. And that's where individual ethical practices differ institute to institute. But as research students, we all have to follow common guidelines across.
Yes, ma'am. So,
yeah. Thank you so much for sharing that, Trina. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Ma'am, we have another question from Madan about paid joints and is it ethical?
Meera, can you read that out, please, for me?
Yeah. We have heard about paid journals. Is it ethical to publish there?
Technically, no. I mean, there is something wrong, right? If they're expecting you to pay for all the hard work you've done. But I know there is a large number. Also, UGC, I think every year publishes list of journals which are fake, which are... So as a research scholar, you will have to be very, very careful about this. It's a trap. It's a black hole. You know, so you will have to, again, it's, but it's a very personal moral thing. There are a lot of people who pay and publish. So you will have to, it's a personal moral choice at this point. But ideally it's a black hole you're getting into and you don't want to be the Alice there. So, yeah.
I think we are running a little of time and we have many questions. So if there are any more, take it up on WhatsApp. We'll be opening the...
But I think we have more or less answered most of the common things that have come about. Okay.
So...
yes, Ashwin, they charge for open access, but if they charge for publication, then there's a problem. If it's just for open access, it's a different thing. And there are a lot of journals who charge for papers. We know that, but that's because they also have a particular amount they pay to the authors. So there is a particular agreement between them and the authors. It's a very, very complicated space. There is no easy answer, but you will have to, what I would say is be very careful of the journals you publish in and the kind of journals you want your work to be seen in. Okay, but today with open source, there are a lot of journals which are good journals, which are also easy to publish in without paying them any money. So you will have to find a way. Sorry, Meera, I cut you in. I was taking that.
No problem. So I think with that, we'll probably conclude this today's class, and we will be seeing you again next week.
Yeah.
So thank you, everybody, and I should thank both Dr. Madhima and also Dr. Sankita ma'am for facilitating this platform for all of us, and Niharika Sharma, who is behind Zoom facilitating. And my God, I'm really running short of words today. So yeah, and thank you, Ashwini and Abhishek, for being with us today, and all of you all for being such excellent participants. So we'll see you again next week, and please don't forget to put in your attendance as well. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, everyone. There are a couple of things you'll have to keep in mind for the next few sessions. I will send the list with Meera a little early on. So you will need to keep maybe pieces of paper and things like that. We'll do a little creative things over the next 6 hours. Okay.
So, all right. Thank you so much, everyone. When we send the reminder, we will remind you of all of these things as well. Thank you, everybody.
Yeah. Thank you. Have a lovely day, everyone. Thank you so much, Meera, Niharika, Ashwini, all of you. Thank you.